Okay, so we are going to look at the pectoral region and the axilla, which is this area that you're looking at. And we already did this, right? It was a fracture of the clavicle. So notice how this side, you can, this clavicle is subcutaneous throughout its length. It's actually the only long bone which is placed horizontally in the body. All other long bones are vertical. So this one is fractured. And this is something that you can actually diagnose the moment the patient just walks in. Notice how the contour of the shoulder changes immediately. So this is a very easy diagnosis. So let's look at the regions of the upper limb. So, you know, loosely when you talk and you say arm, you could mean, just in general English, you could mean anything from the actual arm, which is here between the shoulder and the elbow, to you might even be talking about this part. But when we look here, this is the arm, which is also known as the brachium. So you will find the word brachial used, brachium. You'll find the word brachial being used to describe anything in that area. And this is the forearm, this is the hand. This part here, of course, is the shoulder. And this armpit area is known as the axilla. Now, the skeleton of the upper limb, which is called the appendicular skeleton, is attached to the axial skeleton, which is the central skeleton. That means your skull, the vertebral column, the rib cage, and the bony pelvis. So this is the axial skeleton because it's in the central axis of the body. So this appendicular skeleton is attached to the axial skeleton by a girdle which is known as the pectoral girdle. And this pectoral girdle is made up of the clavicle and the scapula. So if you pay attention to this picture here, so the clavicle is really a very important bone. It's like a strut connecting the appendicular to the axial skeleton. So the weight of anything that you're carrying, even the weight of the upper limb, but let's say you're carrying a bucket of water, the weight will pass through the hand, it'll pass through the wrist joint, it will go into the radius because only the radius participates in the wrist joint, not the ulna. And then later when we do the forearm, we'll see that the radius and the ulna are connected by a membrane called the interosseous membrane, which means between two bones. So from the radius, it comes to the ulna. So both of them, I will go through this again when we do the forearm. It'll pass into the elbow joint, into the humerus, and the humerus articulates with the scapula to form the shoulder joint. So here you can see it's articulating with the scapula to form the shoulder joint. The scapula sits on the posterior aspect of the thoracic cage. And so those of you who can't see this, make sure you look in the lab. So on the posterior aspect of the thoracic cage is the scapula. It is not connected to the axial skeleton at all. It's just sitting on it. So the only connection the upper limb has is where the scapula articulates with the clavicle at the lateral end. And that part is what is called the acromioclavicular joint. So the weight goes all the way up like this into the shoulder joint, into the scapula. From the scapula, it goes through the acromioclavicular joint. It comes through the clavicle. It will come to the sternum, down the sternum, and go all the way through the ribs to the vertebral column. And that's how the weight gets transmitted down the axial skeleton into your lower limbs and out the body. Okay? So if the clavicle is fractured, you can understand the entire weight, the upper limb is going to sink, which is why the shoulder is sort of drooping at that point. So there are certain areas in the upper limb which are known as transition zones, where either important structures are present or the name changes in those areas. So these important areas are, one is the outer border of the first rib. So in the first rib, the outer border of the first rib, and we'll see that there's a name change over there. For example, subclavian artery becomes the axillary artery. Axillary vein becomes the subclavian vein. So that's one transition zone. Then in the axilla, there are important structures. Also, at the lower border of the axilla is another name change. So the axillary artery becomes the brachial artery. Then you come down in the cubital fossa, very important structures lie there, plus there's the artery divides in the cubital fossa. And then these structures, some of these structures pass through and they get into the hand. And where they get into the hand, they pass through a little tunnel over there, which is known as the carpal tunnel. So that's why we call these areas transition zones. So not everywhere is there a transition. Some areas, they're only just important structures. But these are areas you must pay key attention to. So we'll begin with dermatomes. So I don't need for you to know individual nerves, the cutaneous or the branches to the skin, but I do want you to pay attention to certain things. So if you look up here at the shoulder, it's C4 and C5. So remember, we did this earlier when we were doing anything to do with the irritation of the phrenic nerve, goes and gets, the referred pain is at the shoulder. Also look at the dermatomes, and you'll notice that the cervical dermatomes are present on the lateral aspect. The thoracic dermatomes are present on the medial aspect. And this T2 and T1 are particularly important because the T2 intercostal nerve, it not only supplies the skin on the front of the sternum, but it also gives a branch, a large lateral cutaneous branch, which comes into the medial side of the arm. And that's why referred pain in relation to heart problems gets referred to the medial side of the arm. When we did the heart, we talked about that. Now, in relation to this, I also want you to kind of pay attention. On the medial side, which is this side, there is a nerve which is called the ulnar nerve. So there are branches of the ulnar nerve which really supply the medial side of the hand here. In this area, which is the C7 dermatome, it's the median nerve which supplies this area. And on the lateral side is the radial nerve. So this makes sense because I'm sure you remember from undergrad days, the radius is the lateral bone of the forearm. The ulna is the medial bone of the forearm. So we were talking about dermatomes of the upper limb. So I just told them how the cervical dermatomes are cervical spinal nerves. They supply the lateral side of the upper limb, and they supply this part of the hand as well as the medial part of the hand. But the okay, they're working on it. So again, we'll see. Okay, so we were talking about these dermatomes. So on the medial side, notice the thoracic dermatomes. And if you remember this T2 dermatome from the front of the chest when we were doing the intercostal nerves, this T2 had a large lateral cutaneous branch which comes in to supply the floor of the axilla and the medial side of the arm, which is why this the referred pain from the heart comes to the medial side of the arm. So in the upper limb, if you all look at the back of your hand, you will notice a venous network which is present. This is known as the dorsal venous network. There's no fixed way that this network is. If you compare each other's hands, you'll see that it's very different. But one of the common things is that from either side of a finger, from what is known as the contiguous margins of the finger, digital veins travel down, they form a network, and then from the lateral end of this network, a vein begins, which is known as the cephalic vein, and from the medial end of this network, another vein begins, which is known as the basilic vein. So here, if we look, so this is showing you the posterior or the dorsum of the hand. So the basilic vein travels all the way up medially and it joins the brachial veins. The cephalic vein, which is on the lateral side, travels all the way up the forearm, crosses this area of the cubital fossa, travels along the lateral side of the arm. It actually lies in a little groove between these two muscles, the deltoid and pectoralis major, as you can see here. And then finally pierces the fascia to drain into a vein over here, which is called the axillary vein. Usually in the cubital fossa, it shouldn't be difficult for you to see, there is a vein which connects the two veins, the cephalic and the basilic. This vein is known as the median cubital vein, or also known as the anticubital vein, anti meaning in front of. So the way this median cubital vein is present, it could be a little Y shape like that, or it could be straight across, and that differs from person to person. This vein is usually seen quite clearly and often the site for where you take intravenous samples. So this is one concept that I want you all to understand very, very clearly, and so I don't want you to memorize it. So let's look at some terms we use when we describe muscle actions. We normally try to call them muscle attachments, and muscles are usually attached to bones, and they cause one bone to move and one bone to remain fixed. The part which is fixed is known as the origin, and the part which moves is known as the insertion. Most of the time, it's the proximal end. If there is a muscle which is attached, for example, to give you an example, if there is a muscle which is attached to the humerus, and so that would be the origin, and then it goes on to get attached to the radius, which would be its insertion, which is the distal attachment. Now think about it, which part is going to move? Is the humerus going to move over the and wrap itself over the radius, or is the radius going to move over the humerus, right? So usually it's the distal attachment which moves, and so therefore the one that doesn't move we call origin, the one which moves we call insertion, okay? If you look at the same thing when you compare the axial with the appendicular skeleton, it is very difficult for you to move the axial towards the appendicular skeleton. But you can move the appendicular skeleton either towards or away from the axial skeleton, right? So you can bring your arm to the side of the body, that movement is called abduction. You can take it away from the side of the body, that is called abduction, which is the same for the lower limb, right? You can move it across, you can move it backwards. So therefore, when you have a medial to lateral attachment, it's going to be the lateral attachment which moves towards the medial attachment. So if you think sensibly, if you have a muscle attached to the sternum and the costal cartilages and it goes across towards the humerus, can you move the sternum towards the humerus, or can you move the humerus towards the sternum? The humerus towards the sternum. Same way, if you have a muscle attached to the pubis, the front of in the hip bone, the front part, and goes to the femur. Can you move the pubis towards the femur, or the femur towards the pubis? The femur, right? So most of the time, this is the principle. Though I will tell you, sometimes you can move the axial skeleton. I'll give you examples when you can do that. But this is kind of a general rule that you have. So let's look at when a muscle contracts, and here when we have done many types of muscle contraction as you must have done in physiology. So here when I'm talking about a muscle action, I'm mainly talking about a muscle contracting, shortening, and causing a movement. Okay? So when we talk of these muscle actions, think of a muscle as a rubber band. Okay? So when it shortens, then think of how that movement is going to occur. So in our first introductory lecture, the first ever lecture that we had, we talked of movements like flexion and extension. Flexion is known as a bending movement. It's also a movement where the angle between the bones forming that joint decreases. Or it is also a movement, and this is important, where two ventral surfaces come close to each other. Okay? Two ventral surfaces come close to each other. For example, the front of your torso is anterior, but it's also ventral. The back of your torso is posterior, but it's also dorsal. Okay? So when I kind of flex my neck like this, can you see that the front of my neck is coming against the front of my chest this way? So this is two ventral surfaces coming close to each other. If you look at the elbow joint, the front of your arm is ventral, the front of your elbow is ventral, they also both happen to be anterior. So when I flex my elbow joint this way, notice how this ventral surface is coming against this ventral surface. Okay, the angle is also decreasing, it's a bending movement. And when I take my forearm back like that, that is extension. Now you can also do flexion in the case of the shoulder as is shown here. So here there is no bending motion, there's just a movement forwards. So this is why this definition of flexion becomes important, because the front of your arm, which is the ventral surface, comes close to the front of your chest wall, which is the ventral surface. So when I do flexion of my shoulder, So I take my arm across my shoulder like this. So can you see that this part, which is the ventral surface, is coming against the ventral surface? So this is flexion and this is extension, the opposite. So here you can see that here this part is the ventral surface coming close to each other. So flexion of the shoulder is the movement of the arm going across the chest. Extension is the opposite movement. Okay? Abduction is a movement away from the midline. Adduction is a movement towards the midline. Medial or internal rotation is when the any anterior part of the bone sort of rotates medially and posterior part rotates laterally. That will be lateral rotation. So let's look at some principles and determine some general rules. So when we have a muscle which crosses in front of a joint, so let's say we have a muscle which crosses in front of the elbow up here. Okay, so it has a proximal and a distal attachment. Remember, this would be the origin, this would be the insertion. It's like a rubber band, like I said. So if you have this muscle being attached to the humerus, and let's say it comes down and is attached to the radius or ulna, any bone of the forearm, this is going to remain fixed. Imagine this rubber band shortens. What is it going to do? It's going to pull this forearm bone closer towards its origin. So it's going to cause flexion. Meanwhile, while flexion is occurring, you can understand that the extensors, which are on the posterior aspect, they have to lengthen so that they allow this flexion to occur. Now, when they contract, so imagine this rubber band which was stretched. If it contracts, what is it going to do? It's going to cause extension. So therefore, muscles crossing in front of a joint cause flexion. Muscles crossing behind a joint cause extension. This is for all the joints in your trunk, all the joints of the upper limb and the thigh and the hip joint, that is. So this rule holds true. But from the knee downwards, this rule changes. And that's important for you to know. From the knee downwards, this rule changes. The reason being, during fetal life, so that's a fetus up there. And this is the upper limb appendage, this is the lower limb appendage. This upper limb appendage grows, so it grows like this, and it comes and sits by the side of the body. So this would be the ventral surface, and at the back there would be the dorsal surface, right? So when this upper limb grows and comes down like this, the ventral surface still, an awful upper limb, but the ventral surface still faces anteriorly, the dorsal surface still retains its posterior position, the arms, the limbs just come to lie by the side of the body, okay? In the case of the lower limb, what happens is that the lower limb twists. So somewhere around mid-thigh region, the lower limb twists. So this is this part is the hip joint and this is the thigh. Somewhere here it twists in such a fashion that the ventral surface actually goes posterior and the dorsal surface comes anterior, which is why you can see the way your foot is, right? Because when I ask you to flex your knee, what do? The flexion is at the back, right? Because the back of your calf and the lower part of the back of your thigh are the two ventral surfaces. And they become ventral because of this twisting which occurs in the lower limb. Okay? So that rule changes from the lower limb downwards. So therefore, flexion of the knee will be done by muscles which cross behind, and extension will be done by muscles which cross in front of the knee. In the case of the foot or the ankle, muscles crossing in front of the ankle will therefore cause extension. And what is that extension called when you talk about the ankle? Dorsiflexion. And muscles crossing behind will cause flexion, which is same as plantar flexion. Okay? Then let's look at the movements of adduction and abduction. And if you think about it logically, it makes sense. So again, you have a muscle with a medial attachment and a muscle. One attachment is medial and one attachment is lateral. So let's take a huge muscle like the pectoralis major, which is attached medially up here to the sternum clavicle ribs and goes across to the humerus. If this muscle contracts, what is it going to do? It's going to pull the humerus closer to the midline, right? Closer to the parts where it's attached. So that way it's going to cause adduction. Similarly, in the lower limbs, you have a group called the adductor group. They are attached to the pubis and they cross the joint and go towards the femur. So when they pull, they cause the femur to come closer, like when you're standing at attention. So muscles with a medial to lateral attachment pull on the lateral attachment, bringing, so from a medial to lateral attachment, so let's say that's the humerus here, and up here is the sternum and so on. So medial to lateral attachment, they'll pull the lateral attachment closer and cause adduction. Abduction is a movement where you move away from the limb, away from the midline, sorry, where the limb moves away from the midline. So in order to move the limb away from the midline, if you had a muscle which was attached along the lateral aspect of a joint, and let's say I take the shoulder or the hip, it doesn't matter which joint. If there's a muscle which is attached on the lateral aspect of the joint, having a proximal to distal attachment, with the proximal attachment being fixed, and when it pulls on the distal attachment, it's going to try to bring this closer to this. So when it shortens, what is going to happen? The limb is going to move away from the midline. Do you see that? So that is going to cause abduction. And a good example is this muscle which forms the contour of your shoulder, which is called the deltoid muscle. So the deltoid is attached both to the clavicle and the scapula. It's one muscle which completely envelops the shoulder joint like this. So when it pulls, it's going to try to pull. It's attached to a part on the lateral surface of the humerus. It's going to try to pull the humerus up towards it. And the only way it can do that is if it lifts it up like this, causing abduction. So you can see that abduction will occur. Okay? So muscles causing abduction attach on the lateral aspect of the joint with a proximal and distal attachment. In the lower limb, you have two muscles called gluteus medius and minimus, which we'll see. They also are attached in a similar fashion, coming from the hip bone, going to the femur along the lateral aspect of the joint. So when they shorten, they move the limb away, which is when you stand at ease. So that's a general rule that we have. Muscles crossing in front of a joint will naturally cause medial rotation. So imagine muscles crossing in front of a joint like this will pull on the anterior aspect and turn it medially. Muscles crossing behind will pull on the posterior aspect and turn it laterally. Okay, so that's another general rule that we have. Crossing in front cause medial rotation, crossing posterior cause lateral rotation. So remember these rules and then it becomes easier to understand what the action of the muscle would be, and you don't have to memorize those actions. So in the pectoral region, we are going to look at these muscles. Of these, pectoralis major and serratus anterior are the main muscles that we'll talk of. Pectoralis minor is rather small and subclavius is even smaller. It hardly really has an action. We'll also look at a deep fascia that we see there called clavipectoral fascia. We'll see these nerves in this area, and these are the branches. We already, when in the pectoral region, when we were doing the thoracic cage, you already saw the intercostal arteries, right? So now we will look at, and we mentioned at that time the axillary artery, but now we are going to look at the axillary artery in a little bit more detail. So this is a good review cheat sheet for you. You do need to know the attachments. I'm not particular about you remembering major, you know, attached to the medial one-third of the clavicle and goes to the lateral two-thirds of the upper border of the humerus. I don't want you to remember that much, but definitely you need to know where its origin is, where its insertion is. You need to know this for the lab as well, because unless you know the attachments, you really can't work out the actions. Then you're just memorizing the actions, okay? So you do need to know the attachments, these major attachments. You need to know the nerve supply, definitely. And I'll tell you this, wherever a nerve has a dual nerve supply, you must know that. And usually you will find there's a good way of remembering some of these nerves, especially because when nerves lie in compartments, they usually tend to have a common nerve supply. So if you remember it that way, it makes it easy. And as I said, that try not to memorize the actions, try to kind of see, look at where they are present and what the actions would be. So here let's look at the pectoral region. So here's this big muscle here called pectoralis major. On this part you can see another muscle which has little slips called digitation. So this muscle is called serratus anterior. It's called serratus because when you look at the muscle border kind of appears serrated like teeth of a comb. So that's why it's called serratus. It's present in front, so it's called serratus anterior. Here are intercostal nerves, the cutaneous branches of intercostal nerves that you see up here. You can see some of them up here. So when you remove the skin, that's what you'll see in this area. So let's look at the muscles. So there is this big muscle present on the front of the chest wall called pectoralis major. You can see from this picture it arises from the clavicle. That part which arises from the clavicle is called the clavicular head, and then it arises from the sternum and the costal cartilages as well, so that part is called the sternocostal head. This whole muscle from this massive origin moves laterally and goes and gets inserted on the humerus. In the lab you will do the humerus has a little sulcus present here. That sulcus is called the intertubercular sulcus. It lies between the greater and lesser tubercles. So it has two lips. So this goes to the lateral lip of that intertubercular sulcus. Notice how the fibers are inserted. Look at these clavicular fibers. They are coming down, and pay attention, they are crossing the shoulder joint anteriorly. So notice they are lying in front of the shoulder joint. So they cross the shoulder joint anteriorly, and as they come down they insert lowest on the lip of the humerus, on that intertubercular sulcus lip. These medial fibers, they are going right across like this. So they go travel across, and as they go, the lowest fibers actually kind of wind around. So notice how they're winding around these upper fibers. So they kind of wind around and form a little fold, so that the lowest fibers actually insert highest up on that, on the humerus. The middle fibers insert in the middle, and these highest fibers which come from the clavicle insert lower down. Because of the way this insertion is, if you would all sort of take your arm out, abduct your arm, you can feel this fold over here. See, can you feel this kind of rounded fold? This is known as the anterior axillary fold. So a little fold is actually formed by this muscle, and we'll see it later where it forms a wall of the axilla. So this is known as the anterior axillary fold, which is formed by the fibers of pectoralis major winding around each other. So from this you should kind of have worked out the actions that I talked of. Here these clavicular fibers are crossing from above downwards, crossing in front of the joint. These fibers are going medial to lateral, straight across like this. Okay, so they're going medial to lateral. Plus all of these fibers cross in front of the joint, so as far as rotation is concerned, you should think, if this muscle contracts, what is it going to do? It's going to turn it medially. This, once you cut the pectoralis major, underneath you see a tiny muscle called pectoralis minor, which arises from the ribs and goes and gets inserted on a process of the scapula called the coracoid process. So when it acts, it will pull the coracoid process down. So you can see it kind of will depress the scapula. So this muscle here. Then there's a tiny muscle which I don't even know whether you can see, but on your own thing you can see this very, very tiny muscle going from the first rib to the clavicle called subclavius. Pulls on the clavicle, but it's so small it really doesn't have any particular action. Now coming from the clavicle, going all the way down to this axillary floor, is a thick fascia which is present. Fascia is just connective tissue, which is known as clavipectoral fascia. as the name suggests, from the clavicle in the pectoral region. So what it does is it arises from the clavicle, encloses the subclavius muscle, then becomes one layer and splits to enclose pectoralis minor, then again fuses and comes down. So it's a very thick fascia, and it just is present in this region here, in the pectoral region. The nerve supply of pectoralis major is by two nerves, lateral pectoral and medial pectoral. I may not mention the nerve supply of all the nerves when I'm talking, but you'll always have a chart which gives you the nerve supply, so make sure you kind of look at that. So since we can see these nerves, we can see the lateral pectoral nerve here and the medial pectoral nerve. It's a large muscle, so that's a dual nerve supply. Pectoralis minor is supplied just by the medial pectoral nerve. Tiny muscle, just one nerve supplying it. And the subclavius has its own nerve, which is called the nerve to subclavius. And when we draw the brachial plexus, we will see this nerve. So just sort of keep this in mind, nerve to subclavius. Now these actions which I described of these muscles is their main general action. And if you remember, I said most of the time the axial skeleton doesn't move and it's the appendicular skeleton which moves. But however, you can also understand, and when we did the thoracic cage, if you remember, way, way back, I don't know how many months ago, that we talked of the diaphragm and the external intercostals were the inspiratory muscles. But we also said that you had accessory muscles of inspiration, which were pectoralis major, pectoralis minor, sternocleidomastoid. So here is how this pectoralis major and minor can act as inspiratory muscles. During the process of inspiration, what happens? Your volume of the thoracic cage increases, right? Your ribs become more horizontal, the sternum moves forwards, right? And the diaphragm descends. So imagine someone has severe asthma. So if you've ever watched somebody with that, what they usually tend to do is, you know, they'll have a couple of pillows put and they kind of put their arms on that, on those pillows or cushions. So their arms are fixed. So can you see that the insertion of pectoralis major is fixed, as also the minor. And now when it acts from here, what it can do is it can actually pull on the sternum and the ribs and kind of lift it up like that. So can you see that it can help to increase the volume of the thoracic cage? So that's how these two muscles can be muscles of inspiration, accessory muscles of inspiration. Okay? So having looked at that, I didn't tell you the action. Which of these do you think would not be an action of pectoralis major? I mean, I know you all can't log in, or can you? I don't know. So, well, somebody here answer. Which of these do you think would not be an action of pectoralis major? Or let me see, how many people think abduction is the right answer? Just one, a hesitant two, three... Four, abduction, five, six, okay, seven, maybe. Okay, how many think abduction is not going to be an action? Nobody. How many think flexion is not going to be an action? Mm-hmm. And how many think medial rotation is not an action of pectoralis major? No. So the rest is, rest of you didn't raise your hands, like, no opinion. Right? Okay. So let's look. Abduction is the correct answer, and here's why. These fibers are going from medial to lateral. Obviously, when they shorten, they are going to pull the humerus closer. So abduction is going to be there, right? These fibers also insert on the humerus. So notice when they contract, they're also going to turn the humerus this way. So they are coming across like this. So when they pull, they'll also rotate the humerus medially, because the shoulder joint is a joint called ball and socket joint, where all three types of movement are possible. So remember that principle, crossing in front of the joint. So when they pull the front towards them, they also rotate it medially. So medial rotation is also an action. These fibers which cross in front of the joint and they're coming from above downwards. So when they pull, the clavicular fibers are going to try to get the humerus closer to the clavicle, and the only way that's going to happen is if the humerus goes across like this. So by pulling the humerus across like this, can you see the muscle has shortened? So they will cause flexion. In order for abduction to occur, which is when the humerus goes across like this, see, this muscle is going to be stretched, it's not going to shorten. So abduction would not be an action of pectoralis major. Okay? Next muscle is serratus anterior. So this arises by 8 digitations. So the 8 slips from the 8 ribs, upper 8 ribs, travels along, as you can see, along the side wall of the thorax. So it travels along the side wall of the thorax, passes deep to the scapula. So here's the scapula lying here. So it lies, goes this way, passes deep to the scapula this way. So you can see this, it's kind of passing deep to the scapula and comes and gets attached on the medial border of the scapula. So it goes all the way like that, passing along the side wall. So here the scapula has actually been kind of moved apart. Otherwise the scapula would be lying over the thoracic cage, but it's been moved apart just to show you that. So it comes and gets attached along the medial border of the scapula. Usually, because it has 8 digitations, usually about 1.5 digitations or 1 digitation attached to the upper angle, 5 digitations attached to the lower angle. So look at this concentration, 5 digitations come to the lower angle, so there must be a reason why you have so many at the lower angle. And then the remaining 5 and 6 and whatever, 1.5 or 2, the remaining are distributed along the medial border. So most of the digitations are concentrated along the lower angle and the remaining distribute themselves between the upper angle and the rest of the medial border. Since this muscle is coming from the anterior part of the ribs, traveling all the way along the thoracic cage and then going to the scapula, when it shortens, what is it going to do? It's going to try to bring the scapula forward. So it's going to try to bring this medial border of the scapula here. So now the scapula will lie somewhere there, which is that you can, if when you punch something, so you push your arm out like this, and if you put your hand on your lower border of the scapula and then you punch, you'll notice you can feel that the scapula has moved. So this movement where the scapula moves along the chest wall and comes forwards, that movement is known as protraction. So that movement is called protraction. It also causes rotation of the scapula, and that's why you have these 5 digitations which are present here. And let me show you how it will cause rotation. So when you do abduction, so notice here the humerus lying by the side, when you do about 90 degree abduction, so if you're doing 90 degree abduction, this is where your humerus will be, right? So the humerus is then going to hit the acromion. Can you see this? This is the acromion up here. So if I do 90 degrees, can you see the humerus is going to hit the acromion, okay? You can't do any more abduction. But we know we can actually reach up like this to pick on something, and you know, you can do overhead abduction this way, where you can take the humerus all the way up at the shoulder joint. The only way that will be possible is if, for example, so here I have the humerus. So at 90 degrees, you see how it hits the acromion. If I want to do overhead abduction, the only way I can do it is if I rotate the scapula also laterally, and then this way the scapula also rotates, and that way I can move my humerus up this way. Can you see that? Okay. So that's the only way that can happen. So here you can see at 90 degrees the scapula is straight, but when you go beyond that, you can see that the scapula is also rotating. And along with the rotation, the glenoid cavity begins to look upwards more, and that allows the humerus also to reach higher up. This rotation of this inferior angle of the scapula, rotating this inferior angle of the scapula laterally, That is done by serratus anterior up here. That's why you have five digitations present at that inferior angle, so that they can pull on the inferior angle and rotate it. So it causes lateral rotation to help with overhead abduction of the arm. Okay, so that's what happens when we have the serratus anterior acting. Now, if the serratus anterior, is supplied by a nerve which lies on the front of the chest wall, and that nerve is known as the long thoracic nerve. I don't know if you did this nerve. Okay. There's this long thoracic nerve which comes off the roots of this brachial plexus, which lies just on the front of the chest wall, very just under the skin, so it's easily injured. So this long thoracic nerve, if it is injured, which happens quite often in chest wounds, or those days when they used to do radical mastectomy, they don't do that anymore now. Certain viral diseases tend to affect it, and someone gets a big hit on this lateral chest wall, you might contuse that nerve. If that nerve is affected, then that side serratus anterior will get paralyzed. So you get something known as winging of the scapula or a winged scapula. So when you ask the patient to push against something, the way you test it is you ask the patient to push against something. So when you push against something, your scapula should move forwards along the chest wall. So it should, there should be protraction. But in these people, protraction doesn't occur. So the scapula, the medial border of the scapula actually sticks out like you can see here. So it looks like the wings of an angel. So that's why it's known as winged scapula. So let's take a look at this lady who has this condition.
Are you sick of flipping pages to learn anatomy? Are you bored of uninspiring practices?
So see, she's been asked to push against. She's strong, yeah. So here she can, she's doing overhead abduction, and notice this. So can you see that? See that? She's going in front. So you can see how the serratus anterior on this side is paralyzed. And do you notice how the medial border stood out? So see, sticking out. Okay? So this is winging of the scapula. Okay, let's stop here and... Okay, we'll now look at the axilla. So it's a pyramidal space which you see up here between the upper limb and the thorax. And you'll notice it has an inlet which is also known as the apex. We have the floor which you could also call the base. And then it has walls. So there's an anterior wall, there's a posterior wall. So imagine if you draw a pyramid like this. Okay, so there's an apex, there's a base, there's an anterior wall, a posterior wall, a medial wall, a lateral wall. So imagine if you put a little box in there. So that's what it is. So we look at all of these borders. These are all written down for you. So look at them, and we'll kind of identify these structures. So first is the apex of the axilla. So the apex of the axilla is present between the outer border of the first rib. So I'm going to draw this. So this outer border of the first rib, the middle of the clavicle, and the upper border of the scapula. So you notice this little narrow thing. This is how structures either enter or leave the axilla. So that's called the apex, or also known as the inlet. Just opposite it, this area would be the floor or the base. So when your arm is by the side of the body, the floor is much lower. When you take your arm away from the side of the body like this, when you go across, you can see that the floor gets raised, right? Looking at this picture, you can understand that this would be the all muscles present over here, which cover this part. This would be the anterior wall. Behind this part, all of that there would be the posterior wall. This here would be the lateral wall. And this here would be the medial wall, right? Okay? So we'll see muscles and structures which go across in front would form the anterior wall, muscles and going behind would pass the would be the posterior wall. Any muscle present along the medial side here would be the medial wall, and anything present here on the lateral side would be the lateral wall. These are the contents of the axilla, and right here you can see you have blood vessels, nerves, there'll be lymphatics, and these structures form a communication between either the neck and the axilla or between the thorax and the axilla. So notice this. So let's take a look at the anterior wall. So here is that space up here, and here's the anterior wall. So first is this pectoralis major muscle. So this pectoralis major is the first muscle you see which forms this anterior wall. Okay, if we cut pectoralis major, then below it we see subclavius, pectoralis minor, and that clavipectoral fascia which is stretching between them. So these structures therefore form this anterior wall of the axilla. Now if I removed all these structures, then I would be able to see here, I would be able to see behind, which is the posterior wall. So in this image, what has happened is all of these structures have been removed, and now I'm looking at the posterior wall. So here is the posterior wall. So when you look at the posterior wall, these are all the structures which are present here behind. They are hidden in this picture because these are here. In the posterior wall, you have three muscles. This muscle is called subscapularis. This muscle below it is known as teres major. And then we have a huge muscle which actually comes from the posterior part of the back. It comes from the iliac crest actually. It's from the iliac crest, on the posterior aspect of the iliac crest. So a lot of it is present on the back area. And then this muscle twists around the teres major. Notice how it's kind of twisting around the teres major. And it comes to insert on the anterior aspect of the humerus in actually the intertubercular sulcus. So this muscle which arises from the back travels along the back and then twists to come anteriorly, and it twists along the lower border of teres major. This big muscle is known as latissimus dorsi. So all these three muscles, look at the similarity, they all arise medially and they're going laterally. So see this, they're going medially and they're going laterally. So medially, medial to lateral. So start thinking of what their actions could be. Now where this latissimus dorsi twists around the teres major, there is that fold which is formed, which is known as the posterior axillary fold. So again, I want you all to put your arm out, abduct your arm. Remember I told you this part here was where you felt in front, the anterior axillary fold which was formed by pectoralis major fibers winding around themselves. And then you can also feel a fold on the posterior aspect, which is this posterior axillary fold, okay, which is formed by latissimus dorsi winding around teres major. So there at the back, there is where the posterior axillary fold is. I also want you to pay attention, the lower limit, notice that when it folds over the teres major and comes to insert, you can still see the teres major, the lower border of the teres major up here. So the lower border of the teres major, this part here, the lower border of the teres major is the lower limit of the axilla. So when any structure comes from the axilla, crosses this lower border and comes into the arm, for example, the axillary artery becomes the brachial artery at the lower border of teres major. Or the brachial veins become the axillary vein at that lower border. So that's a transition zone, okay? Let's look at the medial and lateral walls, and we can see this walls here as well. So you can understand that this would be the medial wall of the axilla up here, And then this part here would be the lateral wall of the axilla. So this would be lateral wall, and medial you can't see here, but this would be the medial wall of the axilla. So in this picture, that's what is shown. So this is the medial wall of the axilla formed by the upper digitations of the serratus anterior, about four digitations of the serratus anterior. And the lateral wall of the axilla would be this area, which is the intertubercular sulcus. And lying in the intertubercular sulcus, some books give that also as part of the lateral wall. So you can see that the lateral wall is very narrow because the axilla kind of goes out like that, right? So this lateral wall is very narrow. Lying in the intertubercular sulcus is a two muscles. One is called coracobrachialis and the other is the tendon of the biceps, long head of the biceps, So that forms the lateral wall. So here you can see part of the posterior wall is still shown, where you can see this fold quite clearly. So let's look at this question. Which of the following actions do you think would be common to latissimus dorsi, teres major and subscapularis based on how they are going? Which would be a common action? So those of you in St. Croix, why don't one of you answer? So it's going from medial to lateral. So think, when it shortens, what is it going to do? There will be a common action. All three of them went from medial to lateral. Number four, adduction, that's correct, right? Is that what you were meaning to say?
Yes, it was.
Okay. I did hear adduction, right? Or was it someone here who said that? Okay. Yes, adduction. So, yes, they will cause adduction. So, you can understand because they're going medial to lateral when they shorten, that's what they do. They cause adduction. But they'll have other actions as well. We'll see later. Let's look at the contents of the axilla. So the contents are blood vessels, which is the axillary artery. So it's a continuation of the subclavian, which you all did subclavian when you did head and neck. So at the outer border of the first rib, the subclavian becomes axillary. It's divided by pectoralis minor into three parts. So first part of the axillary artery, second part and third part. So axillary artery and its branches are contents. Then axillary vein is a content. It continues as the subclavian vein at the outer border of the first rib. Then we will see the cords and branches of the brachial plexus. This brachial plexus is formed by the ventral rami of C5 to T1 spinal nerves. We will see an axillary group of lymph nodes. We'll see some fat in the axilla. Always, wherever you have lots of blood vessels, nerves, there's always a fat padding which is present. And in women, the axillary tail of Spence, or just the axillary tail, is also seen in the axilla. So here, let's look at all the contents. So you can see the axillary vein becoming subclavian, the axillary artery. The brachial plexus begins up here in the neck, but the cords and the branches are seen in the axilla. Then we have this axillary group of lymph nodes. So we have a whole heap of lymph nodes in the axilla. And here's another diagnosis. What do you think is the matter here? The swelling here. Yes, it's the axillary tail. And because it's present in the axilla, in some women, during the menstrual cycle, as the hormone levels fluctuate, go up and down, they find that with the menstrual cycle, they might see a swelling in the axilla connected to the breast, and then the swelling comes and goes. And that should tell you that it's just the axillary tail and it's not anything that they should really be worried about. Okay, so that is the axillary tail. And this is where the axillary tail, notice how this axillary tail is going into, the breast is in the superficial fascia, but just the tail becomes deep and goes into the axilla. So when we looked at the axillary artery, then the three branches which you need to know, the first part has one branch, the second part has two branches, the third part has three branches. So the first part of branch that it has is called the superior thoracic or supreme thoracic, because it's the highest thoracic artery that it gives off. Second part has a branch which we saw when we were doing the thoracic cage. We saw this branch, we mentioned it, how it anastomoses with the intercostal arteries. This one is called the lateral thoracic artery. And then we see a branch called thoracoacromial, which really divides into four branches. And they go, these four branches go towards the deltoid, clavicular, pectoral, and acromial. You don't need to remember all these, but just in case someone wants to know, these are the four branches that it goes to, okay, thoracoacromial. And then we'll see the third part, we'll see two arteries which kind of wrap around a part of the humerus, and that part of the humerus that they wrap around is known as the surgical neck of the humerus. So since they go around, they are known as circumflex. Circumflex means to go around. And then we'll also see an artery called subscapular. And subscapular gives off a branch which again wraps around the scapula. So that artery is called circumflex scapula. And after it's given off that artery, the remaining part of subscapular is known as thoracodorsal. So let's look at these branches. So here is the axillary artery at the outer border of the first rib. It becomes axillary, covered by pectoralis minor into a part superior or above. That's the first part. The second part is deep to the pectoralis minor, and then the third part is inferior to the pectoralis minor. And then at the lower border of teres major, this axillary becomes the brachial artery. From the first part, you have this branch called supreme thoracic. From the second part, you have thoracoacromial, which gives off a clavicular branch, an acromial branch, a pectoral branch, and a deltoid branch. So these are the branches: clavicular, acromial, deltoid, and pectoral. And a branch which lies along the lateral wall of the thorax called lateral thoracic. This one's lateral thoracic. Then you have the two circumflex humerals, the anterior and posterior, so they go around the humerus. And a branch called subscapular, which gives off circumflex scapula, and then the remaining part is called thoracodorsal. So if you look up here, the same arteries are shown. So here's superior thoracic supplying the pectoral region up here, thoracoacromial which supplies the pectoral region as well as the shoulder area, lateral thoracic along the lateral wall of the thorax. Here are the circumflex humerals which go around the humerus, so notice these. And then you have the subscapular, which gives off a branch which will wind around the scapula. So this is called circumflex scapula, and then the remaining part is known as thoracodorsal artery. The axillary vein, nothing very significant about it. It receives the cephalic vein, and at the outer border of the first rib, it continues as subclavian. At the lower border of teres major, it's a continuation of the brachial veins. The brachial plexus. So I want you to look at this picture carefully. I'm going to do the break. I don't want to start the brachial plexus today, even though we have time, because I would really like everybody in class to draw this. So if you look at this brachial plexus, so notice this plexus. In the neck, you can see roots. Roots will join to form trunks. Then trunks divide, and this is the clavicle, which is shown here. And after dividing, then they form cords, and then cords form branches. So notice this is the order. So roots, to trunks, trunks form divisions, divisions give rise to cords, cords give rise to branches. Notice where they are all present. So if you got this question, which of the following statements is true? Someone in Miami Shores, because I asked St. Croix, someone in Miami Shores, tell me which of these statements is true.
Two.
Yes, very good. The roots and trunks are in the neck, the divisions are behind the clavicle, and the cords and branches are in the axilla. The cords cannot be in the neck because the cords are the last part of the brachial plexus. The trunks are also present up in the neck. So if you look, go back to this picture, you can see roots and trunks in the neck area. You can see the divisions behind the clavicle, cords and branches in the axilla. So this brachial plexus formation we will do